Hachette Audio presents You Can Live the Dream, trading disappointment and discontentment for peace, joy, and fulfillment. Written and read by Nick Nilson, with an introduction written and read by Joel Osteen. Hey, this is Nick. Hey, I just wanted to take a minute and say thank you. Thank you for buying this audiobook. I truly believe that it's going to be an investment into your life. I don't believe it's by coincidence or by accident that you're listening to this right now. And my hope and my belief and my prayer is that every time you finish listening, that you'll finish encouraged, inspired, and better than you were before. Friend, it's time to live the dream. Let's dive in. I want to dedicate this book to my wife, Summer. Summer, your love, your joy, your passion, and your faith inspire me. I'm forever grateful I get to live the dream with you every day. You saw this book in me long before I ever did. I love you.
Hi, this is Joel Osteen. My friend Nick Nilson is an amazing leader, an insightful minister, and a gifted speaker. For more than 17 years, Nick has served faithfully and passionately as an indispensable member of Lakewood Church's pastoral leadership team. His love for the Lord is the centerpiece of Nick's life, and he serves as an example of how to lead at work and at home. He's a natural team builder, a great husband and father, and a wonderful friend. I can think of no one better to write about making the most of where you are than Nick. Sometimes the most difficult place is to be where you are, especially when it's not the place you had hoped to be. We all plan for our future, dream our dreams, and put into motion everything necessary to see our aspirations come to pass. Yet oftentimes, we find ourselves frustrated by the timing of it all. You spend 4 years in college, study diligently, and graduate with honors, only to find that every prospective employer wants you to start at the bottom, perhaps even work for someone that didn't go to college at all. It's easy to become discouraged. Perhaps you've worked hard to save for that new home, the one with the backyard where your children can play. Yet it seems that every time you save enough for the down payment, something unexpected happens. There goes a chunk of your savings. That can be disheartening, to say the least. It is times like these when you have to set your mind and choose to believe that your dreams and goals are given by God. Big dreams require not only faith, but patience as well. The question may not be whether you have faith in God, but whether you're willing to wait on God and to do so with expectancy and joy. That last part, joy, may be the most difficult for us all, but it is critical if you're going to achieve your dream. Joy comes from knowing that when you're not where you want to be, God has your answer just ahead. Joy is what keeps you energized and diligent in your efforts. Joy is the reason that entry-level job is not a setback, but a challenge to do your best. Joy brings you to your job early each day, before anyone else arrives, and gives you the edge over your competition. Joy shows God that you've not given up on the dream, and that's why you'll be ready when He places opportunities in your path. Joy is what keeps you looking for that perfect house. It's what drives you to visit open houses and call realtors and scour the internet, even though you're short on the down payment right now. When the present isn't working out the way you thought it would, staying joyful can be a challenge, especially considering how much easier it is to become disappointed and discouraged. It's difficult to be living the dream when things don't seem to be going your way. But living the dream means exactly that, living. It's not a moment, it's a way of living your life. Joy doesn't come and go with your circumstances. It stays regardless of what your current situation is. You may be asking yourself, how am I living the dream when I seem to be stuck? It's a good question, and it's one that Nick answers in this book, You Can Live the Dream. Through countless examples and personal stories, Nick takes you on a journey that is fulfilling as the destination itself. I encourage you to listen to this book with expectancy and joy. Let today be the day you start living the dream.
Introduction. You were made to live the dream now. Not next week, not next month, not next year, but right now. You know, it's easy to think of the dream as a destination to which you hope to someday arrive. Perhaps it's when you have a certain amount of money, or you're happily married with two kids, or you have an impressive title next to your name. Or you may think your dream will begin when you're an empty nester, retired with a great 401k plan in place, or finally feeling healthy again. From a young age, we're taught that true happiness will be experienced when we arrive at life's mile markers. All of these mile markers are great, but I want you to see how they can limit you from living the dream until you reach those destinations. I've discovered that we don't have to live long before we find that happiness is far more elusive than reaching a destination. If we expect to find happiness when we finally move into a certain size house or get the big promotion and salary we worked so hard for, we're going to be disappointed. Don't waste another day chasing the dream. Stop limiting and delaying the life you dream of living. It's within your control. In fact, you could be just one perspective shift away from living the life you've always dreamed of living now. A destination or a mindset? When I was in my mid-20s, I began using a phrase that has become a regular part of my vocabulary. You know, someone ask how I'm doing, or they call me. I haven't talked to them in a while. And they say, hey, how you doing? I typically respond, I'm living the dream. I know, it's nothing new. You've heard this idiomatic expression before. Maybe you've seen it on a t-shirt or on a bumper sticker. People use this phrase to describe a good time with friends. It's been used in ads that show a brand new house with a shiny Tesla in the driveway. Some empty nesters use it as the slogan for the season of life when their last child has moved out. I see it often used as the perfect caption for the family holiday Instagram post. In whatever way you've used living the dream or seen it used, the general meaning assumes an arrival, that one's ideal life is being experienced in some way. You have the dream house, the dream job, the dream family, or experiencing the dream trip. But for me, it carries a different meaning. It doesn't necessarily mean that I'm where I want to be in my career or that my latest vacation was Instagrammable. It doesn't mean that everything in my life is awesome and going as planned. It doesn't mean I don't have challenges and struggles that I'm facing and working through. For me, it's a mindset that I choose to have regardless of what my life looks and feels like on the outside. Living the dream is all about perspective. It means that I'm fighting to keep the right perspective on where God has me right now. It's a reminder that each season matters. It's a declaration of my present contentment and confidence in Jesus, as well as the future that He has in store for me. The X factor that changes everything. I heard a story about a young man who had trained to become a shoemaker. But there were already two shoemakers in his village. So he packed up his tools and he went to another village looking to start his business and to become successful. When he arrived at the village, he saw that no one was wearing shoes. He was so disappointed and frustrated that he turned around and he went back to his home village. When his family asked how his business prospects looked there, he said, "Terrible! No one wears shoes there. It's a closed door." Soon after he left that village, another shoemaker went to the same village. He saw the same people walking around barefoot. He pulled out his tools and he spent the next few weeks showing the people his shoes, demonstrating how they worked, and fitting some villagers with their own custom pair. The news of his shoes spread, and soon his business boomed. When he went back home, his family asked how the business was doing, and he replied, "It's fantastic. I can't keep up with the demand. I'm going to have to hire an assistant soon." Two shoemakers walked into the same village, faced the same circumstances, but they had two different perspectives. One saw an obstacle, a closed door, and walked away. One realized it was the opportunity of a lifetime that could become a flourishing success. I've seen this same dynamic at work in so many people's lives. I know people who come from the most difficult circumstances, poverty, and dysfunction, yet they've become very successful and fulfilled.
And I know many others who grew up in a healthy environment and come from wealthy families, yet who are discontent and miserable. What's the difference? What is the X factor that explains the contrast? Perspective. The difference is the perspective they have chosen to have on their life and circumstances. I like what the Apostle Paul says about the perspective we should have in 2 Corinthians 5:7. He says, "We live by faith, not sight." In other words, faith is all about how we see our lives. You see, it's easy to focus only on what you see happening in your circumstances and allow that to dictate how you think and feel and respond. But I want to encourage you throughout this book to stir up your faith and walk in confidence, believing that God has you where you are for a reason, and He will finish what He started in your life, and He will get you to your destiny. You see, you can't control all the things that happen to you in life, but you can control how you see them as well as how you respond. Your perspective makes all the difference. How you see your life. Living the dream is all about having the right perspective on your life, as well as recognizing where you need to change how you see your life. You see, it's all about how you see your relationships. It's about how you see your finances and opportunities. It's about how you see your past and your future. It's about how you see your problems and setbacks. You can be in the middle of a financial setback and choose to see or believe that God is working it out for your good. You can be in the middle of turmoil at work and have the steady confidence that God is in control. You could believe God's promise that He'll take you through a fiery furnace or a den of lions, and nothing can keep you from your destiny. You can choose to see things in your life through the eyes of faith and believe that there is opportunity even in the midst of opposition. The question is whether you believe the difficulties and barriers are keeping you from your destiny, or you see them as occasions for God to show Himself to you. Do you see them as opportunities for growth, as God's means to equip you for what's ahead, or as reasons to be disappointed and to throw the towel in? I want to encourage you that with a powerful perspective shift that may defy what you've believed for years, you can begin to say, "Hey, I'm working two jobs, neither of which I planned on doing, but I'm living the dream. I'm divorced, and yes, it's painful, but I'm living the dream. I'm paying off a big debt, but I'm living the dream. I'm single, I've been waiting for a long time, but guess what? I'm living the dream." It's time to stop chasing the dream and start living the dream. Today, friend, you can experience the life you were designed to live. You can live the dream. Chapter 1, Drowning Worms. Choose the right perspective. I couldn't wait to take my 5-year-old son, Denver, fishing for the first time. It was so exciting to start this lifelong tradition with him. I went out, I bought fishing poles, I bought snacks, I bought this big container of worms for our time together. And there was this spot on a bayou near our house that I thought would give us just an awesome introduction to fishing together on this summer afternoon. All we had to do was sit on the concrete bayou bank, bait our hooks with some worms, cast them into the stream, and wait for fish to strike. So we sat for about 30 minutes, eating sunflower seeds, watching our lines for a bite, but there was nothing. To my surprise, I look at Denver, and he's being fairly patient. I mean, every so often he'd reel his line in, take the dead worm off, and ask me to help put a fresh one on. And then he'd just sling his line back in the water and sit back down. After about an hour of this, Denver remained unshaken and content. I, on the other hand, I was done. I wasn't having any fun. I was hot, and we hadn't had a single bite. So we packed up our gear and we headed home. Now, to me, as we're heading home, I'm thinking, this is a major fail. I mean, I was hoping this would ignite this bond over fishing that would last us a lifetime. But we caught nothing. I mean, not even a nibble. I mean, I was worried that Denver would want to never go fishing again. So I broke the silence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.